So, I think I'd like to welcome all of you to the Book and Leaf Writers Read series. We have a really special night tonight because we're having our first theater performance of two plays. But we're going to start with the open mic, which is one of our traditions because I happen to be one of a group in several writing groups, and I love the people that I read and write with. And it's wonderful to have people come and share a brief selection of their poems. So our first person is Kathleen McKinley Harris, who has also been a feature reader here. So let's give her a hand. Yay. Hey.
When I read last time, one of the things I did was to read my children's picture book at the end, and that came out quite a few years ago, but one of the most delightful things that happened after that was that I became a reader doing presentations in Vermont schools and libraries, and I ended up going to 43 different libraries and schools all over the state, even as far away as Island Pond. And I didn't expect that. But apparently if you become a writer, you become a sought-after person in the schools, at least if you've written for children. And this one I wrote, February is I love to read month. And that is the title of this poem. And so children's writers are sought after all over the state. Maybe they are elsewhere too. And that's the title of this poem. February is I love to read month. I wait alone before the labyrinthine bookcase towers, while the teachers herd the junior high kids into the heart of the school. Sit down on the floor. No, there isn't room to spread out. Some of you will have to stand. And all good boys and girls sit on the carpet in low riding faded blue jeans, bold plaid or brown or blue work shirts, heavy leather belts, boots, and an attitude any first year teacher can recognize from the other end of the school. A gang of large eighth grade boys swaggers in last, lines up outside their seated classmates against the back wall, like bull buffaloes ready to battle, their eyes and mine on the same plane. You boys there, watch it, you know who I mean. The teacher who picks the fight, I figure, is staying in the system to max out her retirement. The children are her enemy. But we didn't do nothing, says their leader. And he is right. The boys in the back and I look at each other. Assess. Okay, lady, show us. We know we'll be bored. During the hush before I'm on, I glance at my audience. Gather myself up. Try to promise them with my demeanor I will deliver something worth your 45 minutes. And in the same moment, I see a few of you are privileged, but some of you come from trailer parks, little cities where neighbors are too close, single parents too many, paychecks too small, work hours too long, and some of your parents gave up the land after generations of farming, traded a way of life for a trailer. Some of you, maybe you young bloods in the back, are not readers, and rich or poor, You have permanent files of unmet needs. And so in the dead of winter, a teacher hired a children's book writer to beguile you with a story, perhaps persuade you in 45 minutes. There is a light and a way out when you open a book. So much depends on a story. That was published in the Society of Children's Book Writers and Illustrators Bulletin. And this one is about the property that my parents owned in Hyde Park that's on the market now. I'm sorry to say, 125 acres, more or less. Bear fear. While we were growing up, with the land reverting to woods around us, and over the ridge of McKinstry Hill, the wildness of the Diggins, and ours, the last house on two dusty tracks, with grass in the middle brushing the oil pan, we sat around the wood stove before bedtime when company came, and the men told tales of boundary disputes, ghosts and bears. But we didn't believe the one-handed World War II veteran, the land surveyor who said, "I never carry a weapon. There is not an animal in the Vermont woods which is not afraid of me, except for man." We children, brought up on bear stories, grew fearful to walk old sugar woods roads. We sang and whistled and shouted to fend off bobcats and bears, and our racket worked until one October, when we went to pick apples from a gnarled tree shading the cellar hole on Old Wilson Road. A terrible stench. Everyone said bears smelled awful. And then we saw dribbles and piles of steaming, chewed-up apple vomit. The bear had gorged to spilling over. Heavy with winter fat and wanting more, he had climbed the apple tree, broken a trunk, snapped off limbs, strewn leaves on the ground. We backed away and ran. We knew, too, how once our cousin went for the cows at dawn, and from behind a steeple bush, a she-bear reared up. He stood between her and her cubs. He shot her and both cubs with three lucky shots. Later he found he had only those three bullets. We heard gossip about the neighbor boy the other boys teased about not hunting. The fall, finally he went deer hunting. A bear chased him across an open field, and he thought he was a goner for sure until he came to a summer camp, dove headfirst through a window. A search party found him. We saw the little pane he shattered and wondered how ever did a boy his size squeeze through. We knew most horses spook at bears, but the previous owner said he had seen bears in their pasture when our horses were his. So we did not fret about bears that sunset when we steered our horses up the steep road toward the Diggins. While the horses were blowing, catching their breath after their climb, and we talked, a black animal, surprisingly no bigger than a dog, nor more significant, hustled across the road and into the goldenrod. The horses, glad for flat going after the grade, did not bolt or shy, and my glimpse of the long feared one was so brief, afterwards I never was sure I hadn't made up a bear. That night we rode into the Diggins.
Quite an adventure story in two pages, huh? So our next reader is Ron Lewis, who I call the poet laureate of Brandon. because he's our resident poet and really a wonderful writer, as well as a historian of poetry. So let's welcome Ron Lewis. Come on, buddy.
I'll stand in for him. I haven't read these in quite a while. This is a 9/11 poem. They're harder to write than you think. It's titled, "The Forecast Calls for Falling Steel," for those at Ground Zero on September 11th, 2001. I kept thinking that it's always been frightening to be alive, like being underwater, having to unbuckle the whole family before I ran out of air, and unable to then kick out the windows. What struck me was the panic. The forecast called for a slight chance of torque, scattered glass, and falling steel. Loose blue tiles expected to drop from the day's sundress ceiling that would open up the sky above me. A gaping space where before there was none. I had no kinship with steel, nor the woman who wore shards of glass in her hair. Firemen clutched the old, ungraspable shapes, anchor heavy, 110 floors of shrieking cell phones, stuttering 911, and people ghosting past me. Their murmuring voices whirring like the circular saws in a high school wood shop. In the stairwell, I swabbed complaints from the eyes of women I barely knew, mute and anonymous, all tied together like a string of paper dolls in a private seance, asking me to close the file drawers in their offices. Then the North Tower blew apart like an exploded view of a parts manual. It began to snow as forecast. Nightmares of paperwork fell cursive, confettied the sky as blue as a blue spill of lake, swallowing the sun, settling everywhere, like the migrations of monarchs among the tall eucalyptus of coastal California. I found a dead man's wallet on the sidewalk that I had no heart to open. Chances are you won't remember the severed arm on the rooftop of the ladder truck. At the end of this poem, I wanted to kill someone with my own bare hands. It's called Measuring Time. I measured time by the memories that smelled like dead mice in the walls, unreachable. I measured my days by the number of times my father quit on us, clattering off like a loose hubcap. By the flat line on the cardiac monitor, drawing the signature of his heartbeat, while a nurse wrapped her fingers against his skin to get a vein to rise in the inner nest of his elbow that struggled like an earthworm caught under the blister of his skin. Through the tape of his voice, 10 years after he'd left for good, I'd forgotten that his throat spoke to me like warm oatmeal. I measured days by the soft wax of morning light, cutting a deal with the sidewalks, rainbirds stammering across the lawns, keeping time with the sound of maize and mantle cards, clacking in the spokes of my red Schwinn Phantom. I measured time by the deer skull I found hidden under the leaves, by how long it took it to hold a clutch of wildflowers. I measured time by the revision of each spring, April's gasp of surprise, by the order of bloom, the quiet purpling of crocuses, and the blue flames of wild iris, and the morning glories unfurling fingers, removing trumpets from their cases.
Well, that's lyricism. Really beautiful. Thank you. So our next reader is Emily Lyons. Welcome, Emily.
No?
Oh, I thought you were reading.
No, I'm doing the play.
Okay. So, surprise.
Like, well, I could make something up for you.
our next very tall, very Brandon poet is Robert Black.
I like what you said about making something up. Because that's what I do. I don't consider myself a writer nor a poet. I just take things as they come. You might say I'm a horse of a different color, like the door guard in Oz, right? Or if it was a cheerleading course, I could be called a course of a different holler, so to speak. This was just written in the last hour, and it just came to me today, toward the end of the day. It is actually called Book and Leaf. Life is written on us like a book, unfolding page by page, telling stories of our lives, chapters merging into seasons. Bound together, stories resemble trees, transforming from spring through summer into fall, each one of us, a leaf, out of the immeasurable multitude, one. Yet in the final chapter, does any one of us make any difference? Like this one yellow leaf among so many, that no one seems to see, does its story really matter? Yes, it does. This one matters to me. Thank you.
Boy, that's an exquisite moment of Zen right here. Thank you so much, Robert. I think we may have you doing workshops in instantaneous poetry. Our next poet is Sam Bonosevich. Bonosevich, okay, let's welcome Sam.
I did not come prepared, but I have some poems on my phone, so. Usually if I'm in a new crowd, I read this poem because it kind of encapsulates my feelings of why I read poetry. So this is called I Got Soul, I Got Love. I recount the things I've been told. People keep saying I don't got no soul, but if I bear it all on this stage, will you believe me when I say I've got soul, I've got love, I've got that which you can't get enough of? It's no one's place to judge another on the content of their soul, brother, sister. God, I miss you. Come be with me. We'll live happy like family in this place of indescribable grace on a boat on the lake. For goodness sake, we got what it takes. We'll make it through. Ain't nothing gonna stop us. You know it's true. I'll provide the lyrics and you provide the music. Our life will be a song and everyone will sing along, and we'll find peace in this beautiful land, in the light, in the dark, under view of the stars, watching over us like mythical gods alongside Jupiter and Mars. And we'll learn who we are, a bunch of atoms smashing as fast as light flashing, not a care given to the people trashing our love together, the unbroken wills of two humans tethered forever. Our souls caught in a dance, eyes caught in a trance. We know this will never end because we can endure the bad weather. And we still hear the idle talk. As they walk, people gawk, but we ignore their cries, even if all they do is try to knock us down, to toss us around, make us leave town, as if our love could corrupt their perfect little lives. 1,000 times they've mocked us, some of them trying to clock us, but they'll never stop us. So here's to love, no matter how strange they say, no matter how much they hate. Be yourself, live for yourself, love yourself, and don't give in to the pettiness that surrounds you, the evil ways of those who judge you, and let our voices become a deafening chorus. We got soul, we got love, we got that which the world needs more of.
Oh,
all right. This is kind of a similar note, but I wrote this actually for a called an artist that Stone Valley Arts over in Pulteney did about lakes. So I called it The Lake. Where does one find the lake house of one's heart? That private place on that uncharted road, absent from any map. And where does one find the lake itself? On the mountain where a meteor met a glacier, like I met you with fire, with ice, or when my body met yours, when I kept you warm during those frozen winters, when we blended together, when we became no more than two drops of the same water, when we met just like those two objects. When your gravity plucked me from orbit, like someone plucks a daisy from the wilderness, growing around the lake, growing around my heart. These two centers of existence, the lake with its ventricles pumping blood to every part of its beating living body, my heart teeming with life, providing every plant, animal, and protozoa with all they require, not just for survival, but to thrive, to be at peace in a stable ecosystem. To find this place, then, one must retrace back to when that first astral body crash landed, bombarded the icy surface with chemical fluctuations, with strange sensations, when we crashed into each other, creating the first viable life forms on Earth. Coursing through our nervous systems, forging new paths and patterns, evolving brand new organisms, molding our lives together, this is how we found each other. For we were already there waiting on the other to realize how our pasts had intertwined and our futures too. Because in this boundless lake, we are one.
Well, you make me very happy that we have open mic, because we never know who's going to walk through the door and give us such a great evocation of the spirit. So I'm going to dare to go afterwards with one short poem. Called What's the Hurry, and then we'll move to our first feature. So this is a real life occurrence, I am sorry to admit. What's the hurry? Turtle-like, the officer blinks his eyes, head large through my opened window. License and registration, ma'am? Already prepared, they fit into his square hand. He ambles slowly back to his black shell, blue light flashing its warning to others, semi-numbed by the road, still easing their way up the mountain. I abruptly halted in mid-rise between two peaks, wait and wait and wait. Slowly he lumbers back. Got to ask you a question, might seem odd. Are you in the military? Then, with surprise, you have a perfect record. Yes, I'm careful. Careful, full of cares. Too many jostling for consideration. Second, drive time, dream time, settling in for the long haul. Time stands still, one lane only, no choice but to follow. Rain, sleet, road work, trucks. I ruminate on the $178 cud, remembering his dark, hooded, turtle eyes, slow speech. Ma'am, what's the hurry? An old Italian proverb comes to mind. He who rushes meets death more quickly. Three. Rain slants heavy on the glass. I stare through slits as if the light of sight could penetrate more deeply into the question of this night. Turtle floats, dives, disappears. Ripples skim silvered surface, light holds the center. Eyes rise, slowly blink. What's the hurry? So. Well, thanks for your welcoming of our variety of readers. And now we're going to start the feature part of our program with Margery G. Sharp, who was born in Norwalk, Connecticut, but has lived in Vermont for many years, first in Middlebury, then in Hinesburg, where she resided in a restored barn for 20 years, and now in Shelburne. She was a reporter, did photography, as well as the darkroom work for the weekly Addison County Independent in Middlebury. She's been the editor at the Valley Voice and the Eagle, both Middlebury papers. Margery has reported in the Shelburne News and covered Hinesburg News for the Citizen, two weeklies published by Windridge Publication. Currently, she writes part-time for the Shelburne News. In the 80s, Margery and Kathleen McKinley Harris started and co-owned their own biweekly newspaper in Vergennes, the Champlain Courier, reporting on Vergennes, Ferrisburg, and Charlotte. She's written articles for the Vermont Farm Bureau publication, Fences, and articles for a Windridge News publication entitled Destination, which centered on stories around the Burlington National Airport. She wrote many features for a now-defunct magazine published in Colchester entitled Living the Vermont Way, and also contributed several articles for The Lion, the vehicle for the International Lions Club. So I'm very, very, very honored and happy to have Marge with us tonight, because she is actually going to have performed two of her 10-minute plays, and it's our first theater production here at Book and Leaf. So let's welcome Margery. Do you want this?
No, I just got this.
Well, here, stay here with the mic.
Okay. It says here, good evening. I present for your entertainment two 10-minute plays to be read by a wonderful group of actors, and I'll hold up the program. The first play is Pocket Change. I would ask you to suspend your concept of reality in order to believe in the characters I have written for you. Without further ado, here is the cast. Note the actor Donna Martin will play two characters, not at the same time, however. So thank you. And we'll bring the cast up here, and let's begin. Cast of thousands. Seems that way. And stand where you're comfortable.
Remember to speak up for the
Okay. Oh. By the mic. You want to bring the mic out?
No, I think that the mic will catch it, but just speak up. Maybe you can move over that way. Just
would you like us? The camera is there. As you can see here, we have Dick Rossi, who's playing Randy. Donna Martin is Paul, and she's also going to play the reporter. And Emily Lyons is Buddy. And Kathleen McKinley Harris will read directions, and also she will be the voice. You'll understand when it begins. Thank you.
The setting. At right, outside a restaurant. Sign reads, free Thanksgiving dinner inside. Nearby, several assorted winter coats hang on a coat rack. A sign reads, free coats, take one. A box marked miscellaneous holds socks, mittens, scarves, etc. There's a bench center stage with a newspaper on the seat. Act one, scene one. Randy appears wearing jeans, ragged hoodie over a cotton shirt, no hat, wears shoes, no socks, keeps his cold hands in his armpits, checks box, takes out two pair of socks, sits on bench, puts socks on feet, other pair on hands.
Ah, that feels better. Now for the big stuff.
Looks through coats.
Damn, nothing my size.
A well-dressed man enters at left carrying a man's wool coat. He taps Randy's shoulder and hands him a coat. Randy refuses to wear it. Stranger insists. Randy takes off hoodie, throws it on bench. He puts on coat.
Hey, oh, thanks, man. Wow, feels good.
And adds, boy, do I need this. Buttons it up. Man tips his hat, exits. Randy reaches into a pocket.
Ah, finally warming up.
Finds note in pocket. And says,
you have been chosen to wear this very special coat. In order to keep this coat, you must get cleaned up.